So a couple of weeks ago, or actually last meeting, we passed a conflict of interest policy for the board that had to be done last week in order to comply with the state. But we weren't able to look at it in its completeness. And so that part got passed and this part got sent back to BPRC. So we're going to take a look at this. This is a conflict of interest and campaign contributions overview. And the specific directions from the board was take a look at this. There were some concerns in the community that our conflict of interest wasn't strong enough, so we're going to take a look at this right now. Max, is there anything I should have? I mean, in reflecting what's here, we have two things, the conflict of interest. Right. Well, how did the board...
So here's on number three. So it's under tab three here, supporting material, right?
Right.
You're there? Okay.
Right. So we have our conflict of interest.
Page 53. Right.
We have a supporting materials that's government code section 84308 that isn't specifically directed to school board or local members,
right.
But we're going to take a look at this and see if it should apply to us.
So my reading is the law is the law on this, and we don't really need a policy on it. You know, our conflict of interest was about, you know, us. This really, I don't see how this, frankly, this applies to state. You know, how this would apply, what value it would have being in policy. The law seems very clear. It's been a law for a while. You know, this is not new information. And we can't have every law in policy. But I recommend just sticking with what we passed. And if issues arise, you know, we always have government code section 84308.
Did CSBA come out with any guidance around this?
They, both CSBA and Santa Clara County basically said the same thing, that no, that they don't have a policy about this, is this law. It really doesn't belong in the conflict of interest policy. If you put it in, it needs to go through the county for approval. So their recommendation was, you know, this has existed. It really doesn't need to be in the policy. But that said, they're not interfering with local control.
That's so right.
We can make it a policy.
Absolutely.
If we so desire. But
okay, so
again,
why don't we look at this? Because it came. Sure. Why don't you take a look at this? Well, we have a board policy. I'm just interested in the government code that's attached, which specifically says it's, the Political Reform Act. Okay, let me just read the first paragraph. As previously noted in Chapter 1, discussing financial conflicts of interest under the Political Reform Act of 1974, campaign contributions are not a basis for disqualification by directly elected public officials. However, because of the increased concern about the link between campaign contributions and alleged conflict of interest situations, the legislature enacted Section 84308. So if I look at this government code, it applies to proceedings on licenses, permits, and other entitlements pending before certain state, local boards and agencies. So let me just highlight these and then see what we want to do with it. Because we did not cover this at the board level. There was a plan to send it to us, take a look at it, see what it really said, and then if we need to bring it back to the rest of the board. So number two, covered officials are prohibited from receiving or soliciting campaign contributions of more than $250 from parties or other financially interested persons during the pendency of the proceeding or 3 months after its conclusion. Local laws may impose limits on campaign contributions that are lower than $250. So I guess the state law does acknowledge that localities can do what they want to to address the concern of conflict of interest and campaign contributions. It says covered officials must disqualify themselves from participating in the proceeding if they receive contributions of more than $250 during the previous 12 months from a party or person who is financially interested in the outcome of the proceeding. Yeah, and four, at the time parties initiate, they must list all contributions. So this law, because again, they're not usurping local law, the law expressly exempts directly elected state and local officials except when they serve in a capacity other than for which they are directly elected. So, I mean, the question is, do we want to make sure that we're in compliance and go a step farther? Now, I get your recommendation.
We are in compliance, right? Well,
it's not for you to be in compliance.
No.
Right. It's for we as elected officials to be in compliance.
Right. But I think the intent. I think the intent is really to prevent financial gain.
I didn't hear Heidi's question.
I couldn't hear Heidi's question.
Oh, sure.
She said,
I just said, how does this relate to the Form 700s that we have to file every year? Which are.
Right. And I think the intent, well, I know the intent here is to prevent, financial interests and financial conflicts of interest, especially, to vote on something where you were, might see some financial gain, right? Which is why we fill out those forms. I mean, you have to recuse yourself and report any so now these against the law.
Is this another step? I'm just confused. Would this be another step, or is this just more clarification around?
Well, this would not apply to us. We would have to modify it to make it apply to a local agency, because this does not apply to us. So if we want it to heighten whatever our conflict of interest policy, we would have to modify this in order for it to apply to our local school district. And it's not prohibited, it just says this doesn't do it.
Okay, I'm just wondering if there's a need to go beyond what we're already doing in terms of our disclosures.
That's the question, isn't it? Okay. That's the political question.
I don't see a need, and I haven't seen one, but I have only been here a short time, so. But I will tell you from my past experience with other boards of education out of state, we haven't taken up, and they all have some kind of conflict of interest. I mean, I understand Illinois is different from California. I think it's generally a good practice not to to overextend our reach, and I think our reach and our current conflict of interest policy is appropriate and it serves us well. It seems to be, just
a message. Does this come up in your tenure? Because you've been here quite a
while. Sure, it has. But I'm paying attention to the time, and
okay.
I want to hear if any community members have a point, because I'm going to have to really end this meeting at 4:25 at the very latest. So let's hear from the community. Let's see where we're at, whether we can complete this now or not. So are there any cards? Yeah. So,
you do have
so, yeah. Do you have examples of what you're concerned? Do you have examples about what you're concerned about?
Well, let's hear from the community and see where we're at.
I guess my concern would be that since the law is the law and it's covered, that if we do a policy, because we're also not excluded from doing a policy, although it will have to go through Santa Clara County, so there will be a process involved. It concerns me that there'll be more staff time and legal time to do this, which translates into money. And again, I think that the money really needs to go into direct services to the kids. So since the superintendent has already said that this is not commonly done, and that what we have in place right now covers it, I would like to stand up for please don't spend my tax dollars this way. I don't see the relevance. I don't see that anything, but this does translate into a question is, can you point out things that have happened in the past where it's been a problem, or are you anticipating a problem in the future that would raise to the level of we need to spend both lawyers' fees and staff time on this So that would be my question to you is, has something that large happened in the past, or do you anticipate something that large happening in the future to justify taking the money away from the rep services?
I'm sorry, you still have time. Go ahead.
I think that concludes. I'd love to hear the answer.
Any other questions or comments from the committee? Go ahead, just start. We'll time you.
And would you make sure that Jill gets her name, Andrea?
Sure.
Jill's with Preston to serve us here because we have a lot of people out today. Thank you.
And just to kind of segue on the previous comments, I guess for me to understand, I'd like to know what issues the community has raised, why we're looking at this code that specifically does not apply to school boards, why we would look to add this thing to school boards. It seems very complicated to me if we're going to be looking at every contribution that a candidate has received. And I guess I'm confused as to what business the board has, you know, what the financial decisions the board is making that apply to our communities and our districts. You know, as a parent, I'm just trying to understand why we're trying to add this additional restriction on two board members. So, if you want to explain, maybe what the issue raised by the community was.
Okay. Any other comments? Okay. None? All right. So let's have our conversation and figure out what we're going to do with this. What are your thoughts, Heidi?
Yeah. So, I just would love the benefit of your wisdom, having served for 10 years. Has this come up? I'm sure it has in a variety. I mean, I can see in terms of what financial decisions have been made, you know, we're often contracting with companies to do a building program and things like that. So if someone has a financial...
Well, we can all imagine what it would be. What I was asking was, have things happened in the past?
Exactly. So that would be my question, too, in terms of guidance around.
Given we have two board meetings, we have one board meeting with our current board, and then the second meeting will be with a new board. And I wouldn't mind it having the benefit of that view, that conversation, because I think it's of significant interest, and I can't tell you the number of emails that I get from my Democratic Party about money and politics and the right and how we should do things. There may not be interest for my colleagues, there may be, but I would prefer, it's not for me to, when it was directed here in the first place, it's not for me to say one or the other.
Well, it was directed back here from the board, so I think
we didn't have it before the board. This was the first time I saw it.
It was actually, I think, in the last, included in it.
What we did is we had, the reason conflict of interest even came up,
right,
is that the CSBA sent it to us, and the county required that we, by the end of whatever month, vote on something.
Right.
Unfortunately, BPRC isn't able to move that quickly to get through all of this, which we were not. We could just get through the basics. So this did not come.
I believe it was in the October 28th packet.
This is the first time I have seen this. And it would be my request as, and I'll leave it up to Holly as well. I would like the rest of the board to review this.
Yeah.
And I think they need that direction.
So my recollection is that the reason we did not vote on the conflict of interest policy at the first meeting was because, you're absolutely right, this whole document was in there, but the legal reference was
and you know, I don't, I have to look back in my head.
This was not there, and nor was there discussion about this, and that's why it was sent here, so that we could take initial. I didn't even have a document. Now I have something that was referenced, but it's the first time we're looking at this. And if the board is interested, fine. If they're not, that's fine too. But it is not for this subcommittee to determine the final outcome on, you know, take an initial look. Staff put together at least an initial government code, so we have something to look at. This would not be specifically applicable to locals. We'd have to change it, but I want to make sure. I'm not ready to drop this unless the rest of the board wants to drop it. And they may decide that at the last meeting, the next meeting, or it might have to
go on December 9th meeting. Well,
which would be fun. Which would be fun.
It's too late for the
Yeah, that would be fine. So, I mean, that would be good. That's not our role, is to drop things. It's to at least tee them up. And this at least got teed up into a packet. And I would say, okay, it's for the rest of the board to determine whether we're going to go further on it. And
it would be beneficial for me to understand more about what the board member would want to add to our current conflict of interest code. Because I don't know. It came to BPRC because we're the first place to look at all this stuff. And these supplemental materials were not in our last packet.
These were not, no, we did have a reference to it in the packet.
Right.
But now we do not have this all material.
A reference to this?
To the, we did have a reference to that government code. No, we did not have this material.
I guess I'm just still unclear as to what we are to consider. Like, is it a certain paragraph? Does another board member want us to develop an entire policy from scratch? Do they want just, to add one paragraph into our current code? What is it that's not covered under the Form 700 stuff for this conflict of interest code that they would like in there? So I need more clarification from my colleagues as to what they would like the BPRC to consider.
Okay, so we can bring it to the board and see what folks have to say. It is for the rest of the board to determine if this is a particular interest, and we can see.
I have a process question, and I'd like to use the rest of my 3 minutes. I should be allowed to do that.
I'm sorry. We just had our time. Folks, you have 3 minutes to speak, and I hope people will respect what the rules are. You
right, and I didn't use my whole 3 minutes.
I'm sorry. Please.
So let me just make clear what we're going to ask. So, clarification.
It's a process
issue.
The thing it's a process question that I have. I don't understand the public's input. How do I get a process question answered?
May I have you wait?
So
it's
exactly what you want to go to the board.
It seems to me that this document should go to board as it came to us and say, and it should be teed up as, and what it was teed up to us as, is that we didn't have sufficient time to look at all parameters of the conflict of interest code. It was interested in our reviewing further this government code, which I did not see before preparing for tonight's meeting, or today's meeting. And I want to either get the go-ahead or the nay that we don't want to look further at this because it was sent to us by the committee. And I know this is messier than some because it came to us at the end. Everything was rushed. We had to rush the vote in order to meet the deadline for the county. And so when you're rushed, you don't get everything completed when it should have been completed.
So,
to drop this, it just seemed to me inappropriate.
So we will be at, let me just restate, make sure I have this correct.
Okay. And
it's not an action item.
It's not a neat and tidy kind of
Right. So will we ask for consensus from the board on whether or not they want BPRC to include this language or similar language in
right.
the conflict of interest policy.
Correct.
Is that
okay.
what they're looking for?
Yes.
Okay.
And I mean, obviously this does not apply directly, so I think
right.
that we do want direction. We do want direction on what they want us to look at
right.
or
it's
not look at anymore. I mean,
yeah.
we've looked at it. I mean, I've read it now. It doesn't directly apply. We would have to modify this in order to make it
right.
applicable to a local government. We need direction, one way or the other.
Okay. All right. And so if they ask, all right, that's fine. I'll start there.
Yeah, you know what?
They'll probably ask, well, what do you want?
Yeah, you know what? And we have
yeah.
said that we're
right.
not in a position to
okay.
do that. We can tee
okay.
it up and we can say it would require work in order
okay.
to make it applicable. And frankly, put it before the entire board instead
yeah.
of just us.
And we would need a majority of the board
right.
to want to move forward with this. And just frankly, to provide more information in terms of what is missing from our current whole file.
If anything.
I mean,
right.
I don't know the background, so
okay.
because we haven't had an open session discussion.
Okay.
So, I think aside from the open session discussion about
okay.
the required county conflict of interest form, we have not had a general conversation
okay.
about whether we want anything else added to our current policy or whether everything's not.
Okay.
Right.
Is that on the 9th?
Right.
December 9th?
3 months.
Can it wait? Because this will be before you.
Oh, that's right.
So well, it hasn't been certified yet.
I really would prefer, I mean, because I did say I just dropped a time of 4:20, and I did have a time of 10.
So I just have a quick question.
Okay.
We're probably faster than
please,
us.
Please. But now I feel bad because I didn't allow Andrew again. You know, and Frank.
I'll stick around. I'll listen
well,
to
I
Andrew.
Have
to talk.
I have a question.
She has to teach. She has
but,
a job
but
to go.
Andrea,
right?
Oh, is it a,
I'm on
it
the job.
It doesn't matter. I have to move on to the end.
So here's my quick question that maybe others.
Okay.
Which
could,
is that
well,
I,
let me ask this. Can you take it offline with superintendent, and then however he tees it up for the board meeting, you guys can have that conversation. Would that work?
Sure.
Okay. I would really appreciate it.
Of course.
That.
Thank
okay.
you. Good job.
Great.
Thank you very
all
much.
Right. Thank you. All right. Gavin Close.
All right. Thank you. Good. Thanks for a good day today.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
It's a little more than we can probably chew normally, but.
Yeah. Okay.
But that's okay.
All right.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, Heidi.
Thank you.
All right.
So I'm